So with that in mind, I'm going to start with the discussion that we wanted to do to build a little bit on what you heard so beautifully this morning from Ken. And essentially, my goal with my particular presentation is to sort of augment some of the comments that he made in a way that is hopefully informative. Here we go. Beautiful. Thank you, Matt. And really sort of frame the context, frame the discussion points that he raised in a clinical context that helps you. Now, I'm going to move through this quickly, so I apologize because it's going to be fast, but it's all in your syllabus in a different way. Please note the syllabus is slightly different to what I'm going to show you here. And also, we will have all of this on a web for you, a website for you, so that you can access not just this, obviously, but all the presentations you've heard. All right, wonderful. So these are my relevant disclosures, just our respective partnerships with industry partners. Now, you've heard so nicely throughout the morning, just to recapitulate, that myeloma truly is not one disease. I love the term multiple myeloma because it helps frame that. And as you've heard, it's highly complex at diagnosis, and at relapse, it's especially complicated. Now, I think the very important message from this morning, and to reiterate throughout the day, is that multiple options are available. And as you heard from Jim this morning, we have 10 drugs, and as Ken mentioned, over 25 actual approvals in the last 20 years, which is obviously quite unprecedented. And the good news is how we integrate these becomes a central challenge, and this is adapted from a lovely review by Jacob written some years ago, but helps us sort of understand what to place when and where in our treatment paradigm. As I mentioned in our question and answer session, really treating myeloma has to be thought of as a marathon, not a sprint. So there are strategic decisions we need to make and not just tactical ones. So what I wanted to do in the next 40 minutes or so was quickly cover several key constructs. One is, how do we get over this genomic complexity that you've heard so nicely about from first Ken and then Nikhil? And at the same time, if we target and overcome mutational burden, combination therapies are obviously critical. And if we think about that, it then becomes very important to understand the evolving position and timing of transplantation. Recognizing, as we've talked about before, it's a fundamentally a sort of war horse of our management. It's been a standard of care in younger patients, but going forward, I think we're increasingly approaching it in a tailored fashion. And then I'm going to talk about some of the new directions in protein, excess protein production to some extent, but then just as a segue to what Jacqueline's going to talk about this afternoon, talk a little bit about overcoming immune suppression and cover some aspects perhaps that she won't cover when she talks about CAR T therapy and others. Now, when we think about transplantation-related induction remission therapies and strategies for transplant-eligible patients, I show this slide simply to illustrate the point. Whoops, I'm sorry. Let me just go back. Simply to illustrate the point that if we achieve substantial cytoreduction graphically with the induction remission strategy, we integrate a monoclonal antibody, you can see visually here why there may be an option of needing to intensify if you achieve MRD negativity. And what I want to emphasize is that maintenance is an absolutely vital concept as we think about this. In other words, the implications of maintenance in management are huge. So as we think about transplant and its position, a couple of simple takeaways. Early versus late, we know there's a progression-free survival benefit to its use, but there isn't a survival advantage. So we have to ask ourselves, why? Can you reasonably keep it in reserve? Very importantly, we know that in Europe, where they don't have as much access to new drugs as we do, tandem transplant may be important in higher risk patients, and that's certainly valid from their studies. Our studies, in contrast, in the US have not shown a substantial benefit to this approach. And as we've heard this morning, the acute and long-term side effects of this approach need to be borne in mind. And then I just wanted to share with you some data on quality of life around transplant that we're beginning to learn more about as we go forward. I'm going to move through this fast, so please bear with me, but you've heard already about the importance of the three-drug platform. This is just simply some data to illustrate the points as to why. And here what I've sought to do is show that when we added chemotherapy to the RVD backbone, we really didn't do much in terms of improving the quality of response. And perhaps in that story lies a clue that conventional chemotherapy, if added routinely to novel treatments, doesn't appear to add a huge amount. Then, if we look at the phase three studies that have led to the approval of RVD, you can see them illustrated here. They were led by our colleague, Dr. Brian Dury, and what he shows very nicely is that if you achieve progression-free survival benefit, it quickly translates into overall survival benefit by virtue of the efficacy of the regimen. And if you look at what we call these various subgroup analyses, you can see the signal for benefit is very consistent. This is actually Brian's posting on the NCCN guidelines to illustrate the fact that RVD has become a platform for a standard of care. Now, as Ken mentioned, this has gone globally, and of course, this has had implications for transplant, and you've seen this figure several times earlier before lunch. The simple point we want to make here to reemphasize is that in the French study, lenalidomide maintenance was reserved for only 1 year, which is a critical distinction between our study and our French partners. So what you can see here is an impressive progression-free survival benefit, but interestingly, no difference in survival. In fact, 81% survival with transplant at 4 years, 82% at 4 years for the group without the early transplant. Now, the only point I want to make here, because you've seen this figure several times already today, is that with MRD, if you have a transplant or you don't, there appears to be no major difference except this point. The curves start to separate, but if you notice, they separate after 12 months. Remember, the maintenance that the French used was only 1 year. So maintenance really matters, and in particular, arguably, if you don't have a transplant, in my opinion, based upon certainly a high altitude look at this. So this particular study, which is obviously ours, the US determination trial, in which all of us participated, Jacqueline, Andy, and obviously was led by us at Dana-Farber. This was a 56 center study across the US, and we enrolled over 72 patients, and patients were assigned either to early transplant or late, but critically the lenalidomides continued. And we think that is the core message from our trial to date, is that the maintenance until progression has really mattered. Now, what other information do we have in this space about the benefit of transplant versus perhaps the ability to keep it in reserve? There's been some beautiful work from our Italian colleagues, led by Dr. Francesca Gay, in which she's shown that if you use the KRD platform for a prolonged period, 12 cycles, with or without a transplant, you get very similar results. But very importantly, she's showing that if you have high-risk disease, actually, you have to be very careful about your maintenance, because if your maintenance appears to be just lenalidomide alone in this study, although we don't know from her analysis yet who got what, it may be that that is adverse, because if you don't get transplant, you obviously achieve very high quality responses, but in her early analysis presented at the ASCO meeting and at EHA this summer, there is a higher rate of relapse in higher risk patients if they don't get a transplant. So that's a really important message, because it starts to say, well, wait a second, standard risk patients may not need the transplant, but high risk, particularly depending on what maintenance they get, may need it. So it's a very important message, and it gets to, I think, a critical point, which that high-risk disease may lurk in the stemness of the myeloma. That's where it may be most important to target it. And in many ways, that's why we're so still really really striving to continue to target that stemness in the tumor burden as a way forward. And studies like this give us important clues. But the takeaway is that the chemotherapy piece here, which was just carfilzomib and cyclophosphamide, no lenalidomide, this did poorly, actually, with or without a transplant. It didn't matter. It just didn't do well. Interestingly, if you combine the IMID, the proteasome inhibitor, in this case carfilzomib, with or without transplant, you did great, except if you were high risk. So you had to be careful in that setting. So with that in mind, how are we trying to build on the three-drug platform with the addition of the antibody? And this is data that Ken touched on in the Griffin study, and this is a study led by my colleague Peter Voorhees, and we'll come back to it in a bit more detail in a moment. But the important point was the same sort of message. This did require a transplant. We wanted this as part of it. But what you can see is that if you use the antibody plus the three drugs, the quality of response really improved for those receiving the antibody. It was still very good for those without the antibody, but not as good, pointing to the real benefit of the antibody. Now, this is a slide that Ken showed as well earlier, and I just want to point by point of emphasis. It's a much smaller study. It's only about 30 patients, but these were older folks. The range was 63 to 77, so some younger people there too, and recognizing it uses a different antibody, isatuximab in this case, but you can see here 100% response rate, 92% very good partial or better, and about 50% achieving MRD negativity using next generation sequencing. That's very interesting. The numbers are small, but remember, this is without transplant. So the question becomes then, does the antibody provide the equalizer? Remember what I showed you earlier, that KRD plus the transplant was the equalizer for high risk disease. Is it then the case that a three drug platform plus the antibody becomes an equalizer? And you may say, well, how do you know? We don't yet, but there are some tantalizing clues that it may be. And the most important disease to bring your attention to that's kind of similar in this regard is diffuse large B-cell lymphoma, where we use CHOP Rituxan as a standard of care. And if that fails a patient, then they consider transplant. And it's an interesting parallel to where we're kind of going in the myeloma space. So in summary, we have three and four drug platforms now, and I've put them here. In the interest of updating you from the ASH meeting, there are a couple of important presentations, and again, we'll have them available to you on the web, so please don't worry about the details. This is the Griffin study as presented as an oral session last weekend. What we basically showed was very similar to what I alluded to, the very high quality of responses with the addition of the daratumumab, that it deepened over time. This MRD negativity also improved over time. And very importantly, there was an impact from maintenance. This is what I wanted to show you that Ken wasn't able to show you this morning. If you look at these outcomes, they're really remarkable. Basically, with this approach, disease control and survival is looking outstanding. As Nikhil pointed to earlier, having curves that are at the top side of these graphs is good, and as you can see, all of these curves are sitting solidly at the top, pointing to the continued benefit. In the same spirit, when you put KRD together with transplant, you see similarly remarkable results. This particularly important in what we call the high-risk group, which is interesting, and obviously the MRD guiding remarkable outcomes in that regard. So I'll move through this very quickly in the interest of time, but what I wanted to do is stop, go back one if I may, here. This is a sort of perspective of these studies, because right on the back of this particular trial that I just showed you, Dr. Ola Langren from the Memorial Sloan Kettering Cancer Center presented the KRD DARA data without transplant, and he almost had identical results. Now, we have to be careful because you can't do what we call a cross-trial comparison. You can't say one study tells you how to do it compared to another, because there can be biases that influence that. But it was very provocative. So this gives you a perspective of what I've just shown you, which is that basically Griffin, which was the study I mentioned that we led, versus the master study, which I just showed you, you can see that the MRD testing is giving us an important clue. The point that the presenters were making at the meeting was, though, that whilst we all have to be careful about cross-trial comparisons that I mentioned, the combination of KRD DARA may be that much more powerful, perhaps, than RVD DARA. We'll have to see. I think the important point also, though, and this is very relevant, we have to be worried about drug costs. And the 12-week cost of KRD DARA, 12 weeks, the wholesale acquisition cost of that combination is a staggering $200,000. Now, RVD DARA is much cheaper because bortezomib is generic. So I point that out to you because as you think of these things, we've got lots of factors we have to take into account. So as investigators, we're trying to think more and more responsibly about this because obviously our job is to give best platforms, but we also have to be thoughtful about the strategic view, not least of which is the cost, recognizing that, God willing, costs come down over time. And from my view anyway, there's no possible cap on the value of a better outcome for a patient. Now, with that in mind, I want to touch very quickly on quality of life. Quality of life in transplant, for all of us who care for patients going through it and who've been through it, can be very variable. Some patients do remarkably well, and one of my patients was back at work within 3 weeks of his autologous transplant with high-dose melphalan. Conversely, I've had patients who I'd never have expected to, but have taken literally 6 months to a year to really get back on their feet. Trying to figure out who does better is a key point. It's very interesting because a gentleman, Larry, and I were talking earlier about trying to understand why people do better with certain approaches versus others, and that's a very, very critical question. But in the lieu of that, we do large quality of life studies to try and understand the impact of therapy, and I want to share this with you. This is the IFM study. In our determination trial, we've asked you to fill in questionnaires. There's a very good reason for that, because we want to know how you're feeling across your treatment. At the same time, this is the kind of information that it tells you. As you can see, when you're sick and newly diagnosed with myeloma, there's actually a very high level of distress. This is actually quite significant. Amongst cancers, being sick with myeloma rates as being one of the most distressed of them all, and that's actually against the cancers like breast cancer, pancreas, and so forth. What you can see here, though, is that with RVD-based therapy, everybody's quality of life improves. And it doesn't matter whether you have the transplant or not, you actually end up in the same sort of space overall. What's a little bit surprising, well, not surprising perhaps, but what's important to appreciate is that those patients who undergo transplant, however, undergo a significant dip in their quality of life. And in fact, their measures go to below the diagnostics point as well. So the symptoms they were experiencing at diagnosis during the transplant, their quality of life measures go below that of diagnosis before they recover. Now, this certainly was quite striking to me, and I think it emphasizes the point that the good news is people recover, but it also stresses to me that if you're going to do this, we have to have very clear evidence that you're really going to benefit, because this is a substantial and it's a significant drop. Again, this is one of the first trials to really document this in a prospective fashion. The second thing we have to be careful about with transplant is the risk of these so-called second primaries. Now, they're fortunately low. That's the good news. The thing that we're a little worried about and why we have to fence people off who may be at risk is this phenomenon, that it doesn't seem to stop with time. So the longer it goes on, the more it's a challenge. And this is data published from 2018 from the CIBMTR, which shows that the relative risks of these complications is actually somewhat different, whether it be secondary leukemia or myelodysplasia, over time. And you may say, why? Well, because unfortunately, if you have myeloma, the relative risk of these conditions is higher just because of the myeloma. If you then have melphalan-based treatment, you can see that it does increase, albeit, again, these are very low rates, so I don't want anybody to be unduly alarmed, but the point is that they do appear to be going higher. So our job is to figure out why, and can we therefore protect patients from this by understanding who is it in the group of patients who are at risk of this? And in that regard, in that regard, we're trying to understand what the role of lenalidomide is. Does lenalidomide contribute to this risk? Well, it appears that it does, but it's the interaction with melphalan that is the real driver, because if you look at lenalidomide with Cytoxan or lenalidomide with steroid, it's down here, whereas if you interact with melphalan, it's significantly higher. So what we're trying to understand is how best to protect people from this. And obviously our research directions are, one, we're going to talk about in a minute, the development of drugs like melflufen, which is designed to be a more targeted form of melphalan in a nutshell. And similarly, can we protect patients who may be at risk? And herein lies a clue. This is so-called CHIP technology, so-called clonal hematopoiesis of indeterminate potential. And if it's detected in myeloma patients at a higher rate, which it appears to be, it may be associated with a higher risk of these secondary cancers. So this is not ready for prime time yet, I have to share with you, but I just want you to know that we're making a very earnest and comprehensive effort to really try and nail this down so that we can minimize the risk of this as a phenomenon for patients going forward. Then the final point has been touched on before, and you've seen this figure from Nikhil earlier, but what's important to note is that this particular patient was exposed to high-dose melphalan during the course of their therapy. Interestingly, in patients who have not had melphalan, there was data presented at the International Myeloma Workshop from two groups, our own and Memorial, suggesting that actually in a subset of patients, if you don't get melphalan, the cancer's genomic signature at relapse is importantly different. That's incredibly important, and if that turns out to be true in a larger sense, then it'll start to help us understand who we may really say, please, high-dose melphalan is not the best choice for you. It may, number one, cause long-term toxicities, and two, it may actually leave your cancer uglier when it comes back. Now, we don't know this for sure, who this is and why, but this is an important new research direction. I think you'll be hearing more about this over the next year or two. But the goal is simply, again, to refine tailoring of therapy and make it more accurate for our patients in a way that improves outcomes, as summarized here. Okay, so let's change gears and now talk about newly diagnosed patients who are not candidates for stem cell transplantation. What can we offer you? Well, I want to showcase the RVD light regimen, not least of which, because it was a real partnership with Mass General led by Betsy O'Donnell and Jacob Laubach. It's a really nice study that was done where we basically explored this combination in older patients. And Jacqueline, correct me if I'm wrong, but Beth Israel were part of this as well, which is very important to add. And as incredibly interestingly, our oldest patient was 91, and it was about 50 patients involved. And as you can see, a very nice response rate and an excellent progression-free survival with updated progression-free survival of 41 months presented at ASH. Now you may say, well, what does that mean? What it means is that this lighter combination used in older patients is extremely active because not only is it generating this kind of quality of response, but really excellent disease control over time with really minimal toxicity. So the fun piece of this is we have RVD Classic because we're all big fans of beer. We have RVD Light. And actually, we also now have an RVD Premium Light. And the RVD Premium Light is one that the Velcade's given weekly. So that's the only difference, which is relevant. Okay, anyway, I'm conscious that it's Saturday, and Saturday afternoon close to Christmas. So with that in mind, this is the sort of upfront landscape. It's looking very exciting. And as you can see, we've got lots of exciting options going forward. In the relapsed refractory space, we have a lot of exciting new options as well, so that if treatment fails, then for those treatments that have failed our patients, we then have lots of options for when the disease comes back. I want to spend just a very quick bit of time on pomalidomide. It's a crucial drug that works after lenalidomide fails. This is a study that we published earlier this year, and to Larry's question earlier today, this is a true real-world study. We were very permissive for entry criteria for this trial. We deliberately built this on the pomalidomide bortezomib platform because bortezomib's generic now. It's going to be the value option globally. You might have said, well, why didn't you use carfilzomib? Absolutely, carfilzomib's a very powerful partner, but KPD, active as it is, in a real-world sense, is not approved for most of the rest of the world. So we did this study specifically with the real world in mind. So in that context, we randomized patients to the standard of care at that time, which was bortezomib and dexamethasone continuously versus the addition of the pomalidomide. And to cut to the chase, we were able to show substantial progression-free survival benefit. The response rate, in fact, in first relapse for the PVD combination was in excess of 90%. And as you can see in that group of patients, a very substantial gain in progression-free survival approaching 10 months. Which was very encouraging, and this worked whether you were lenalidomide refractory or not. So these were the conclusions from this trial. Now, talking of real world, we're becoming very aware of this. Bottom line here is that we want to make sure our clinical trials translate into real world benefit in terms of the patient populations who receive them. And in that context, there are some interesting takeaways. Basically, bortezomib-based therapy appears to translate well. Carfilzomib, a great drug, very powerful, but the real-world translation has been more challenging, primarily because of its cardiovascular toxicity and some of the nuances of its management. Interestingly, ixazomib, which is an oral PI, the translation from studies to real-world use is very symmetric, again pointing to its tolerability and the ease of translation into the clinical setting in the community, and similarly for lenalidomide. When we look again at the sort of other combinations, just by way of example, you can see here that for pomalidomide-based combinations, the translation is very good. Again, pom is a very well-tolerated drug generally. A little bit more challenging when you bring carfilzomib into the mix. Panobinostat, a drug that we've long studied and worked hard with, probably undervalued actually for what it really does. It's a great drug in resistant disease, and in particular in the high risk setting, that's more difficult to translate. And Jacob actually has led the charge in better understanding how to use panobinostat so we can improve tolerability and improve efficacy. And in that same spirit, daratumumab has translated very well from clinical trial straight into the community setting. So just to address the question that was raised earlier this morning, this is not obviously inserted since then, we were planning to show this to you anyway. You can see as a program, we're very dedicated to this idea that what we understand from clinical trials translates to what then is delivered to you in the community. Okay, so let's talk very quickly about key targets in 2019. Targeting and overcoming mutations. How can we do this in a clinical sense? Well, I think a very important whole strategy has been that of what we call a T1114 and BCL2 overexpression with the use of venetoclax. Ken explained the science beautifully behind this morning, so I won't dwell on that, but I want to show you some very informative lessons from a large clinical trial, the so-called phase 3 Bellini study, in which biomarkers provided critical information to a study that had initially given us a very mixed signal. The rationale for venetoclax use is very clear, and the data preliminarily are very striking. This shows why, however, and Ken touched on this, I fully endorse the idea of lean, efficient, smaller studies. But bigger trials are essential, because if you don't do them, sometimes you can miss something like this, which became very important. The most important thing about this is that the three-drug platform versus the two-drug platform was offered to a broad array of patients, not just 1114. And what then happened in that study, unfortunately, was that in those patients who got who were non-1114 positive, actually there was a safety signal against the three-drug combination. So this prompted a major effort to try and understand why this happened. And so I think the critical takeaway from these information was that if you were 1114 positive and your cancer overexpressed BCL2, you got substantial benefit from the combination. If you didn't, however, despite response advantage and despite progression-free survival advantage, you actually didn't do well. So where this ended up, and this was the takeaway message, was that in fact, if you had the 1114, you did really, really well. And that was critical going forward. And that's, I think, where the FDA approval will lie. But if you didn't have abnormality, the clinical benefit was far less clear. In fact, it was adverse. And most importantly, if you were non-1114 translocated and you were so-called BCL low, this would not be a drug that you would want to use. It could actually hurt you versus helping you. So the conclusions were very clear that venetoclax, if you're 1114 positive, is a drug that would be very potentially valuable, but don't use it otherwise until we've figured out better how to use it. So what's another approach to targeting these mutations? Well, Ken touched on this earlier, which is this absolutely novel strategy of inhibiting the nuclear export protein mechanism in a way that basically can help. And I guess the best way, I've used this analogy before, and I borrow a little bit of it from a super colleague from now the IMF, Joe McHale, and one that we've adapted ourselves. The way to think about it is this. There's a rave going on at home. Okay, the parents have left. That's what the next nuclear protein does. So the kids are going bananas. This protein stops that and brings the parents back and converts the rave to a wine and cheese. And that's the way to think about this. Okay, I'm sorry, I'm in a Christmas spirit. Does that make sense to everyone? Yeah, we've had beer, now we've got wine and cheese, and we even had a rave. The other way of thinking about it also is that the inhibition of this pathway shuts down social media as well. So in other words, the way the genome is trying to communicate with the cytosol is closed down, so the kids can't Facebook their mates to say, come to the party. Does that make sense? So that's actually what selinexor does. It settles down the party, makes it a wine and cheese, and it stops the social media going out to the kids to say, come visit my home, mum and dad are away, with the consequences, right? So that's the way it goes. And the thing is, it translates into real benefit when everything else has failed. Andy and I were part of this study. And then there was a very nice presentation at ASH from Christine Chen from a study called the STOMP study, where she combined pomalidomide with selinexor, and to cut to a nutshell, basically showed some really nice responses. and an excellent tolerability profile that was much better. And Vincent Rajkumar, who's a, you know, a key opinion leader on our field, who'd been somewhat cynical about selinexor, it has to be said, completely changed his tune and actually said this was one of the most important studies at the meeting, because what it actually did was show that if you combine it with pomalidomide and you're able to reduce doses of selinexor to once a week at lower dose, the results are basically excellent. So this is an exciting new direction. And you should know that selinexor can be ideally partnered with both bortezomib and carfilzomib, and similarly performs extremely well. So challenging side effect profile on its TOD, but if you then combine it with other things, there's real strength in numbers, and it does much better. Okay, I'm going to touch very quickly on this because Ken was very kind about melflufen. We believe in a different way, it kind of tries to shut down the rave at home by delivering the police force straight to the kitchen. And essentially what happens there, the good news about melflufen though, is that it's very different to melphalan in so many ways. It's lipophilic, which means it likes to go to fat. Melphalan does not, which is important because the bone marrow is full of fat. So that in itself tells you something. Second of all, it's activated by aminopeptidases, which are expressed in the myeloma, but not to anything like the same extent in normal tissues. So melflufen, to show you some obvious differences, it doesn't cause mucositis. For those of you who've had a transplant, you may remember the mucositis was really a problem. That doesn't happen with melflufen. You don't lose your hair. That's another beautiful aspect to the drug. It doesn't cause hair loss. But what it does do, and that's where it takes its playbook from melphalan, is it delivers the police force right to the kitchen and shuts the whole process down. Why we think that's so important is because, particularly in extramedullary disease that occurs after all other therapies have failed, you need to get into that stemness of the tumor, and this drug appears to do that. In a nutshell, we've been very pleased with this. This was updated by Sarah Bringham at ASH, where we saw a really impressive survival from this trial. The Horizon study is the largest of its kind, and basically we've been able to show in a very high-risk population a very solid response signal, which we're encouraged by, and we're investigating further. I won't dwell on this in the interest of time, but just to say that it's a really exciting platform going forward. Okay, now what about further targeting protein degradation? Ken touched on this morning with the degronomids and the other parts of the story upstream. I would simply say there was a very important trial practically that was basically looking at carfilzomib, dexamethasone, and daratumumab versus carfilzomib. Carfilzomib, as I mentioned, an outstanding drug, but you have to be a bit careful in the cardiovascular setting. And in this study, they were able to show that by combining carfilzomib with daratumumab, you showed remarkable synergy. This was a large randomized trial led by Dr. Saad Usmani. There were a 2-to-1 randomization because we had the signal that this study was going to be positive in favor of these three drugs. So consequently, rather than having everybody evenly randomized, it was 2-to-1, so that if this is certainly a very active combination, if this was really active, we weren't depriving these patients of access to a better combo. And in that context, you can see a striking pre-FS advantage in favor of the three drugs over the two. And what you can also see is this translated into the response differences that I've illustrated here. And as you can see, the MRD negativity is dramatically better. And the good news is that both groups had excellent survival, but clearly the daratumumab-containing group did that much better. One caution about adverse events, though, and just to be very clear, is that whilst they were generally relatively well-balanced, there was a little more cytopenia with the DARA piece. And importantly as well, what you need to know is that there was also a slightly higher signal of shortness of breath that comes with both daratumumab, perhaps, but to a greater extent with carfilzomib. And then finally, and this is the important one, that you have to be aware that that carfilzomib is not great in the context of renal failure, and also at the same time cardiac failure, and also ischemic heart disease were important signals. Rare, fortunately, but real. So again, I think, you know, powerful combination, but some important side effects. Okay. So I want to now finish up by quickly running through immune suppression, recognizing that Jackie's going to follow Andy in just a moment to give you a much more insightful view. The immune microenvironment is essential to overdriving. Ken touched on this study, but just to emphasize the new role of elotuzumab with pomalidomide, it's a very well-tolerated combination, and we've seen great results from its use, and we're very pleased with its performance. That's a lovely segue into something that I want to showcase, led by Andy, who's right here. This is basically the combination of elotuzumab, pomalidomide, bortezomib, and dex. And why I particularly like this study is because you can see the build here. We see that elo-pom-dex works well. We've already shown earlier that pom-vel-dex works well. So how about if you put four drugs together, which is what Andy did? This is a super study, and it was presented at ASH, and we're looking forward to its publication because I think it's an important contribution to the field. This is the schema, so a nice, easy, user-friendly, and to Larry's words earlier, a very much a real-world permissive study to allow us to enroll patients to it. And in that context, we were very pleased by the overall response rates, and very importantly, we were able to see activity when daratumumab had failed. So in patients in whom daratumumab had failed, we were able to see activity that was quite encouraging, and also excellent progression-free survival compared to what one would expect in such a sick population of folks in whom multiple prior therapies had been used. So we were actually very pleased by this, and essentially what was also encouraging was the excellent tolerability profile. So ELO-PVD, a very nice quadruplet for patients who need it, and again, entirely homegrown with Andy's leadership. I also want to recognize the MMRC who also contributed to that. Okay. Isatuximab, you heard about this from Ken earlier. I just want to bring out one key point from his slide. This apoptotic pathway, it's a very strong way this drug works. It's more of a directed killing against the myeloma through CD38. And Ken already mentioned that this immune suppressive microenvironment is particularly alleviated by isatuximab. Interestingly, in the same model system, whilst DARA possesses many of the same properties, the degree of effect in the model system is less pronounced. Whether or not this matters in the clinic, we'll see. But it's our view that this may really matter because essentially, as Ken alluded to, if everybody's getting daratumumab early, rightfully so, it's such a good drug, we've got to have something smart in the toolbox for when DARA fails. This may be one example. This basically looked at isa-pom-dex versus pom-dex, pom-dex being the standard at the time, and basically the international trial, again, very real world, very permissive, and what we were able to show is that there was a substantial advantage in favor of the three drugs over the two. This occurred in all subgroups. Very important point, patients with renal disease were able to get onto this trial, high-risk patients. Very importantly, also, patients with asthma and COPD were allowed into this trial because when you have daratumumab, you can't have bad asthma or COPD because it can make it worse. So again, this was helpful in that regard. And you can see that there were some striking advantages and a trend towards survival benefit. We built into this study, again, with this whole construct of being very sensitive to translation of clinical trial to clinical practice, we did quality of life. And as you can see, the addition of the third drug to the two did not have any adverse effect on quality of life. So we can anticipate that this will be a well-used strategy going forward. Now, a couple of things to look to in the future. Ken touched on this briefly, but this is the work we're doing with the so-called cell mobs. This is 220. We are also studying 480, which some of you may be familiar with. Sounds a little bit by Airbus, doesn't it? Airbus 220, 480. I guess talking about Boeing these days, you've got to be a bit careful. But in any event, this is 220 versus 480. They both seem to be outstanding new drugs, and how they work is illustrated here. This is how lenalidomide binds to this pocket. And as you can see, 220 is much bigger in how it binds. You see, much chunkier right across the whole thing. And this has all sorts of interesting effects and is much more potent, even more than POM, in its effects in the in vitro systems. Basically, what you see with just a pill, 3 weeks on and 1 week off, very few side effects, excellent response rates. So we're very excited by this, and this is illustrated here. And we're very excited by the progress with 480 as well. I will share with you that 480 is much more powerful than 220. So we're going to see how that goes, but we're very pleased with early results from that. Now, Ken mentioned GSK916. We call this Belamaf. This is another concept of delivering a warhead to the kitchen, getting the police force into the kitchen, but doing it immunotherapeutically. And essentially, it's a so-called antibody-drug conjugate with auristatin as the warhead. What's important to note is that when it gets in and blows up the kitchen, it also throws outside of the kitchen signals that say, come in and kill me. That's very important. We call this immunogenic cell death. So these are very powerful tools. I suppose a better analogy is it's a guided missile. It's sort of like a Hellfire missile coming from a drone. It goes right to where it needs to be. We're very pleased by this drug because, as Ken mentioned in the DREAM 1 study, we saw 60% response rate with a 40% response rate in daratumumab-resistant patients. I want to stress with you the DREAM 2 data are now available. The public announcement is it's met its primary endpoint, which is correct, and we will be presenting that very shortly. We were not able to present it at ASH, unfortunately, but we will be able to present it in the new year. Ken thought this may not be approved until 2021. I think given the strength of the information, we may actually be getting this drug approved as early as next year. It's very powerful, even when five drugs have failed. So we're very pleased with this going forward. BiTEs, you already heard so nicely about. I won't dwell on this other than to simply say, Jacqueline, I think you're going to talk about BiTEs, I think. And just to know, there are lots of exciting ones. This is the one Ken mentioned, and actually Andy is leading here for the Boston Center, 93269, which I think we're all going to be part of going forward. Why are we excited about it? Ken touched on this, but I want to be very quick. You can see the high response rates. And this is a BiTE, it's an antibody infused over 2 hours once a week. I mean, that's very straightforward. And these are the data we're seeing. Okay, and you're going to hear much more about that. So my concluding slide is here. The integration impact of novel therapies in relapsed disease is, I think, quite unprecedented. I think it's worth a few simple takeaways, that we have lots of innovation. We have a wave of immune therapies that, as Nikhil touched on, may be agnostic to mutational thrust. In other words, all those ugly genes, in a sense, the immune therapy doesn't care, immune system doesn't care, it'll just wipe them out. Baseline immune function needs to be improved. Monoclonal antibodies, including the new ones, are essential. Vaccines are very important. Insights into the mechanisms of drug resistance are critical. And I think the venetoclax story gives you an obvious example. In that spirit, we've got great new drugs like selinexor and, of course, melflufen, which are looking very promising. And prognostics, immune profiling, and MRD will guide therapy. This is what the landscape looks at, and you can understand why, for example, we're so hopeful. Because you can see this is just the last, 18, 19 years, and look at everything stacked up here. It's like trying to get into Boston Center during rush hour. We're all kind of poised, ready to do that. And in that same spirit, this is the last first thing I wanted to share. Deb isn't with us today. She's doing her Christmas shopping. But the bottom line is that Debbie allows me to show this case, her case for you with all her approval. Debbie lives on the Cape. Her husband, Harry, is a super guy. And basically, they came to see me back in 2009. She has high-risk myeloma with bad genetics. She also has significant blood pressure problems, which require three drugs. Her local docs on Cape Cod had started on lenalidomide. We thought because of this bad feature here, 17 deletion, would add bortezomib. She had a great response. Actually, she had minimal peripheral neuropathy, thanks not least to Kathy and Deb's peripheral neuropathy cocktails and formula, cocoa butter, et cetera, all helped. She underwent transplant back in 2010. She did well with it, no question. Side effect profile wasn't too bad. She didn't want any kind of maintenance other than pills, and so now probably what I would have offered her would have been exazomib. Unfortunately, however, she only got a year of benefit from the transplant before she progressed. Now, this is a very worrisome group of folks. If folks have disease that progresses within 1 year of transplant, we consider that a particularly poor prognostic feature. So when she progressed, we added back bortezomib, and she responded nicely. She then progressed within a year, though, and we thought about carfilzomib, but this was the problem, bad blood pressure issues. So we actually enrolled her in a clinical trial, and she actually had a very good partial response. But unfortunately, again, pointing to the nastiness of this 17P, she then relapsed very aggressively. When she relapsed very aggressively, it was with extramedullary disease, and then she chose to participate in the 501 trial that was led here at Dana-Farber by Jacob. We published in the New England Journal a couple of years ago. She was actually on the 16 milligram per kilo dose in a phase one study, so kudos to Deb for having the courage to do that. And as you can see, 6 years over, multiple myeloma, in complete remission, she's MRD negative. This is Deb in 2017 at the Cape. Here she is fishing in the Rockies, and then she's trying her luck this year in Vermont. So with that, I think that's what I consider the sort of look of novel therapies as we sit here and stand today. And just to say thank you very much for your kind attention.